Many years ago in Sunday school, I learned the story of Jacob's dream vision. You know, the one with the ladder that extends from earth to heaven and the angels of God ascending and descending on the ladder and God on the top of the ladder speaking down to Jacob. Well, over the years, I've come to realize that there is actually a very rich and somewhat complicated history of interpretation behind that particular event. For instance, if you look in Jewish literature that's contemporary or almost contemporary with the New Testament, so first century Jewish literature, you'll find some interpretations of that particular event that say that the angels of God were ascending and descending not upon a ladder, but upon Jacob himself. Moreover, you'll find that they were ascending and descending because they were going down to look at Jacob's face. And then they were ascending back to the throne of God because engraved on that throne was a human face, the face of Jacob. And so they were comparing one with another. So there's this very interesting history of interpretation, and in some cases, translation of biblical text or a paraphrasing of biblical text that was circulating in the first century or around the first century that is forming part of the background of what Jesus says at the end of John chapter 1 when he talks with Nathanael and says, you're going to see greater things. You're going to see the Son of Man and angels of God ascending and descending upon him. So this is a case where it's good not only to know the Old Testament, but also to know how in and around the first century, various Jews were interpreting and translating and paraphrasing these biblical stories. Because very often we find that in the background of New Testament discussions are these interpretations and traditions of Old Testament text. So what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at John chapter 1, verses 43 and following. We're going to look at Jesus' dialogue with Philip and Nathanael. And we're going to look at the Old Testament background. And then we're going to look at these Jewish texts from the first century and paraphrases from the first century, which are going to help us to fill out a little bit more what is implied in what Jesus says to his disciples. So why don't we start off with what Jesus is going to do as he encounters Philip and then as Philip encounters his friend Nathanael. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Right away, this is a typical first century way of designating a person. He's called Jesus of Nazareth, so this name of his village. And then he is designated as the son of a certain father, in this case, the son of a reputed father, the son of Joseph. So that's a typical way of referring to someone in the first century. Where are you from? And who's your dad? Now, speaking of people, who is Nathanael? Well, Nathanael, you might know, is only mentioned in the Gospel of John. He's not mentioned in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. However, it seems that the Nathanael of John's gospel is the same person as the Bartholomew of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. So here's why. In the synoptics, Bartholomew is listed after Philip in the list of the apostles. And of course, Philip in John 1, the text we just read, is connected with Nathanael. This has led to the traditional identification of Nathanael with Bartholomew. And plus, Bartholomew itself is not really a name. It's an Aramaic and it's a patronymic. So it's really two names. It's Bartholomai, Bar being the Aramaic word for son and Ptolemy being a man's name. So Bartholomai would be son of Ptolemy or son of Ptolemaeus. So if all this is correct, this guy, his full name is Nathanael Bartholomai. Now, Philip says to him that we have found the one that Moses wrote about, and not just Moses, but the prophets wrote about. Now, today, we Christians refer to the first half of the Bible as the Old Testament. It didn't receive that particular name for quite some time after the first century. In the first century, the earliest believers referred to what we call the Old Testament as either the Scriptures or the law and the prophets, or Moses and the prophets. So the law would comprise, of course, the first five books, the Torah, Genesis through Deuteronomy, and then the prophets would comprise everything else, the historical books, the wisdom books, the poetry books, and then the prophets themselves. In time, the Old Testament came to be called the Tanakh. The T is for Torah, the N is for Nevi'im, and the K is for Ketuvim. The Torah, again, the first five books. Torah literally means teaching. Nevi'im means prophets. And this wouldn't be just prophets, prophetic books like Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, but also historical books that were written from a prophetic perspective, books like Joshua, Judges, Samuel, and Kings. And then the third group, the Ketuvim, or the writings, would be everything else, everything from Psalms to Wisdom to Esther to Chronicles, so on and so forth. The main point is that when Philip came to Nathanael and said, "We have found the one written about in the law and in the prophets," he was saying, "We have found the one that the whole Old Testament, the entirety of the scriptures, testifies to." And this one, Jesus himself, says in chapter 5, "You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life." Well, it is these scriptures that testify of me. So we have it from the lips of Jesus as well as from the lips of his followers that he is the fullness and the fulfillment of the entirety of the Old Testament scriptures. Now let's go on. Let's see what Jesus has to say to Nathanael and what Philip and Nathanael discuss as well. Nathanael said to Philip, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite, indeed, in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Now, the first thing you might ask yourself is, why does Nazareth have such a bad rap, right? What's so bad about this particular place? Well, I don't think that's what's going on here. I think that the reason Nathanael says, "Can anything good come out of there?" is because he's thinking in terms of the Messiah that Philip has just told him he's found. Jesus of Nazareth? The Messiah? The Messiah is not supposed to come from Nazareth, really for a couple reasons. Number one, Nazareth is just kind of a backwater village. There's maybe 450, 500 people there in the first century. Moreover, every Jew who knew the scriptures knew that the Messiah was not supposed to come from Galilee, much less from this town called Nazareth. He was supposed to hail from Bethlehem, from David's hometown. And so Nathanael is rightly confused. How could Jesus be the Messiah if he is from Nazareth? Then, secondly, we have this interesting description of who exactly Nathanael is. Jesus describes him as an Israelite in whom there is no guile, or in whom there is no deceit. Now, the reason this is interesting, because Jesus is kind of being a little bit sly here, and he's looking ahead. Keep in mind that at the end of John chapter 1, Jesus is going to refer to an incident connected with the life of David, right? With the life of Jacob, right? The ladder and the angels. Well, when Jacob is introduced, he's first of all named Yaakov, which means heel, but is connected with sneakiness and with deceit, with trickery. And then when Jacob steals his brother's birthright by tricking his father, then Isaac says to Esau that his brother came and took his birthright with deceit. Now, the Greek word that's used there in the Septuagint translation of Genesis for deceit is the same word that is used here in John chapter 1 when Jesus says that Nathanael is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. So Jesus is, as it were, saying, there's an Israelite who is not like Jacob. He's honest. He's straightforward. He's not full of trickery and scheming and deceit. He's a non-Jacob-like Israelite. So that's how he describes him. And then he says that he saw him under the fig tree. Why is this small detail added? Well, this is a bit of conjecture on my part. However, we know from other later rabbinic literature that fig trees, or being under fig trees, was often associated with meditation upon the Word of God, which is just incredible if that's what's implied here, because that would mean that Nathanael, a pious Israelite in whom there's no deceit. He's under the fig tree studying the scriptures when, lo and behold, Philip comes up to him and says more or less, hey, the very scriptures that you're studying, I have found the one of whom these scriptures testify. Whatever the meaning might be, or whatever the implication might be of him being under that fig tree, when Jesus says, I saw you there before Philip called you, Nathanael comes out with a beautiful confession of who this is. He says, not only are you Rabbi, my teacher, but that you are, number one, the King of Israel, and number two, the Son of God. Now, there could be numerous texts that Nathanael is drawing from in the Old Testament where the Messiah is called both the King as well as God's Son. Probably he's drawing here from Psalm 2, though. And I say that because in two verses back to back in Psalm 2, the Messiah is described both as a King as well as God's Son. So verse 6 says, as for me, I have set my King on Zion, my holy hill. I will tell of the decree. You said to me, you are my Son. Verse 7, today I have begotten you. So in two verses back to back in Psalm 2, the Messiah is called the Son of God and the King of Israel, the very same confession that Nathanael now speaks to Jesus. Now, what does Jesus say back to Nathanael? Jesus answered him, because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these. And he said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, and by the way, in the Greek, that you is plural. So I say to you all. He's not just talking to Nathanael. And then he goes on, you, again, it's in the plural, you all will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. Now let's unpack this bit by bit. First of all, he says, you will see. If you go back to the Hebrew of the name Yisrael, Israel, it means God, one who fights with God, one who struggles or wrestles with God. However, in the first century, contemporary with Jesus, there were some interpretations, for instance, Philo, who was a Jewish philosopher living in Egypt, there were some of these Jewish traditions and interpretations which saw the name Israel not as meaning one who fights with God, but instead one who sees God. And if that's what Jesus has in mind here, it's very clever. But because he says to Nathanael, you're an Israelite, you're a God-seer, and you are about to see greater things than these. You will see the heavens open. You, God-seer, will see the heavens opened. And what's going to happen when these heavens are open? Well, now we have an interesting description of two different interpretations. So if you look in an early Jewish Genesis commentary called Genesis Rabbah, you have two different interpretations of the ascent and the descent of the angels. Back in Genesis 28, verse 12, it said that Jacob dreamed, and behold, there was a ladder or staircase, the Hebrew could mean either one, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven, and behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending bo. That's the Hebrew. The last Hebrew word is bo, which usually is translated on it, but could equally be translated on him. This led to some rabbis saying that the ascent and the descent weren't so much connected with the ladder as they were with the person of Jacob himself. Now, why is this important? Because if you look at what Jesus has to say, it seems as if Jesus is making a comparison and contrast not so much between the ladder of Jacob, upon which the angels were ascending and descending, as upon Jacob himself. Jesus says, you'll see the Son of Man and the angels of God ascending and descending upon him, right? So ordinarily, we think of Jesus as the new and better ladder of Jacob, as it were, the one by whom the heavens and the earth are joined. It could very well be that Jesus is reflecting this current interpretation, this current tradition, that instead the angels' ascent and descent is connected with the person of Jacob. And he's saying, no, someone greater and more important than Jacob is here. The angels of God are going to ascend and descend upon me. I am the one who's greater than the patriarch. Secondly, there existed around the first century Aramaic paraphrases known as Targums or Targumim. And in these Aramaic paraphrases, we have a number of very ancient Jewish traditions that were preserved. So they would not only translate the Old Testament, but they would paraphrase, and they would add extraneous traditional material in these paraphrases to kind of fill out the biblical story according to Jewish tradition. Now, a number of these targums or targumim, these Aramaic paraphrases, say unequivocally that there was a human image engraved, a human face, the image of a human face engraved on the glorious throne of God. And this face was the face of Jacob. And so when they paraphrased the story back in the book of Genesis, they would say that the angels were descending to look at the face of Jacob, and then they were ascending to compare that face with the face on the glorious throne of God. Again, knowing that interpretation gives us a bit of background as to what Jesus might be implying here. He might be implying this. No, the human face connected with the glorious throne of God, or the image connected with the glorious throne of God, this human who is so close to God's glory, it's not Jacob. It's me. I am the one who is connected with the throne of God. I am the image of God. I'm the one who reveals the glory of God. So look to me as the epiphany of God's glory, not to the patriarch of old. Now, let's kind of pull all this together. Jesus says, you'll see the heavens opened. That's apocalyptic language. That's the unveiling language. When the heavens are open, you have God about to reveal something. So the heavens are opened. And what's going to be revealed? What's going to be revealed is like a new and better patriarch, a new and better Jacob, and that is Christ himself. He is the one who's going to image forth God's glory on the earth. When's he going to do this? Well, if you look at the Gospel of John, Jesus reveals God's glory in his miracles, such as he will do in Cana of Galilee in the next chapter. He also reveals him in his healings. And then climactically, he reveals him in his crucifixion. That's the great irony in John's gospel. When is God's glory revealed? In the gory picture of the cross. In the crucified Christ, we see the glory of God made evident to all humanity. Jesus says, when I am lifted up, I will draw all people to myself. That's when the Son of Man will be glorified, when he is crucified. That's the manifestation of God's glory to us. And that finally is when we see the fulfillment of what happened with Jacob's dream vision, all the way back in the book of Genesis. Now we see the fulfillment of that in the glorious crucifixion of the Son of God, the glory of God made manifest for us. So this kind of Jewish interpretation is helpful for us to know as we enter into chapter 1 of John's gospel, because it fills in some of the background, exactly what might have been behind what Jesus meant when he had this discussion with his early follower, Nathaniel. Hope that's been helpful to you. If it has, please share it with your friends. I hope that you're all doing well, and I pray that God's mercy and grace may be yours in abundance. We'll see you next week.